Hello guys, this is Paul McWhorter with TopTechBoy.com, and we are here today to begin to explore artificial intelligence at home. What I'm going to need you to do is pour yourself a nice big mug of iced coffee. I'm going to need you to get out your Jetson Nano gear, and I am going to need you to get ready to learn some cool new stuff. Let me start by telling you this is an introductory lesson, and let me clearly communicate to you what my assumptions are in this lesson. My first assumption is that you are already to the point of being able to get your Jetson Nano to first boot. If you are not to first boot yet, you can go to the internet and you can search on getting started with the Jetson Nano. You will be brought to this page, and it has very clear step-by-step instructions on how to download the Jetson Nano operating system. We call it Jetpack. How to download the Jetpack operating system, how to format your SD card, and then how to flash that operating system onto your SD card. The SD card then goes into the Jetson Nano, you bring power to it, and then you should very quickly be to this screen, which is first boot. Okay. My second assumption is that you do not have a PhD in computer science. What I am assuming is that you probably come from the world of the Arduino, maybe played around with circuits a little bit, maybe did a little programming back in the day, but you are not a computer science expert. What my promise is, and what the goal of this lesson and the next lesson is to help you build the foundation such that you can go away and begin to develop your own artificial intelligence applications. Now, what do I mean by the foundation? There are two foundational skills that you need to really be effective in artificial intelligence. The first is you have to understand Linux. You have to be able to navigate and operate from a Linux terminal. The second is you need a working knowledge of Python. And we will do Linux in today's lesson. We will do Python in the next lesson. Now, here's the good news. You could spend 4 years and still not learn everything there is to know about Linux. The good news is you don't need to know all of that. There are just a few simple commands that will allow you to do 90% of the stuff that you need to do. And the few things that you're not going to know, you're going to know enough to be able to figure it out or to be able to find it. So we're going to establish your foundation in Linux today. And then in the next lesson, we will establish your foundation in Python. Now, let me tell you why we're doing this, because the problem that I see is you guys go out and buy these single board computers. You start trying to do artificial intelligence, but you're really just finding tutorials and you're typing in commands that someone else developed, and you're typing in those commands and you don't really understand them. Maybe you can get the demo program to run, but then you don't know enough how to go to actually be able to go away and develop your own application. So what we're trying to do in this Explore AI at Home is build the foundation and build the fundamentals where that you can go beyond just running other people's software. You can start doing the development yourself. So that is enough of this introductory nonsense, and we need to jump in and start learning this. And so to learn it, the first thing I want you to do is I want to kind of tie you to something that you probably already understand. And you probably understand the concept of folders on Windows, where you have a folder, that folder has folders inside of it, then you have folders inside of folders inside of folders. You navigate those folders on Windows with a graphical user interface. You point at the folder and you click on it to open it. It reveals the content. You point and click, it reveals the content. Then maybe you close some of those windows. And so that's how things work in Windows. Well, the good news is the basic file structure is the same in Linux. And in fact, you can come and if you click on this file cabinet, what you will see is you will see what looks like folders. So these are folders. I could click on the document folder and then go inside of that. So it looks almost exactly like Windows. All right. But to really program and to really do artificial intelligence, you got to get away from doing that graphical user interface, and you've got to interact with your file structure using the command line, using a Linux terminal. And so now I'm going to tell you the first thing that we need to do to start getting away from this Windows mindset. And that is, we've got to stop thinking of these things as folders, and we've got to start thinking of them as directories. And in fact, I really, really want to go through these lessons without using the F word again, right? We are not going to say folder again. We are going to call them directories. And in fact, I should probably have a jar here that I should have to put a dollar in every time I use that word, because we've got to start thinking in terms of directory. So we will begin by saying goodbye to our graphical user interface, and we want to bring up a Linux terminal. We want to bring up the command line. You do that by right mouse clicking, pointing at the window, right mouse clicking, and you can see that it says open terminal. Now, when you do that, you will have a window like this pop up, which is your Linux terminal. Now, let's talk a little bit about what you see here. And what you can see is you can see that I've got PJM. Yours is going to say something different, but that is your username. On your first boot, you set up a Linux username, and your username, whatever you are logged in as, should show up here. Then we have the @, and then this is your machine name. When you booted the first time, you gave your machine a name. So I am PJM, the user, on Nano, the machine. Maybe you called yours Jetson or desktop, you know, Nano or something like that. But that is what this is. It is the user at the machine. Now, this dollar sign basically means that it is ready for a command. So at the dollar sign is where you will type in your command. Now, what is between the dollar sign and the PJM at Nano? That is the working directory that you are in. And this little squiggly is a shorthand for your home directory. So what this is saying is I am in my home directory, and then slash inside of the home directory, I am in the downloads directory. Okay, from my home directory down in the downloads directory. Okay, let's learn our first Linux command. What is in this working directory that we are in, the home slash downloads? To see it, you just want a shorthand for list. List what is in there. LS is the abbreviation. So if I type LS, this shows me the thing in this directory. And you can see these blue highlighted words are directories that are inside my download directories, and then the white are files. And so you can see that I end up with files and I end up with directories. Also, these red ones typically are like downloads, and so that's something that I downloaded. So there's color coding to the different things that are in your directory. Well, let's say that I want to go back to my home directory. Well, there are two ways that I could do it. There's more than two ways, but one is the home directory is up one level from where I am. So I could do CD, which means change directory, and just say go up, dot, dot, go up, dot, dot. So CD, dot, dot, and now you can see that it's not showing downloads, it's just showing squiggly, meaning that I am now in my home directory. Wonder what is in my home directory? Let's do an LS. And you can see that I've got other directories, desktop, downloads, documents. We just came out of downloads. We were down in there and we came back up out of it. Excuse me. And then I've got files. I've got the files GPIO, PyTorch train, examples.desktop. I have some files in there as well as folders. Now, a little bit about this squiggly. The squiggly is really shorthand. And the squiggly is shorthand for your working directory. But that working directory is inside of directories, is inside of directories, is inside of directories. So what if we want to go all the way to the top? The top directory we call the root, and there is a special symbol for the root. And the way we get to root is we can say CD for change directory and then slash. That's saying go to root, change directory to the root. And now if you look, you see the squiggly isn't there. It just comes with that slash and it says that I am in the root directory. Let's see what is in our root directory. I can do LS and I've got all types of different things in there. Well, because I played around with it, I know that the path to get back down to my home directory, or yeah, my home operating directory, I would go change directory, home, And now I'm in the home directory. I do an ls, and look, inside of home is pjm. I'm pjm. Pjm is my home directory. And so I can do cd pjm. And now, instead of listing me as being where I really am /home/pjm, it uses this little shorthand and it says, well, you are in squiggly. Okay, but now I can do cd and I can go dot dot. Now I'm back to home. I do ls, there's pjm. I can do cd into pjm, and then it gives the little abbreviation of squiggly. So anytime you want a quick way to get back to your home operating directory, you can use the shorthand squiggly. So let's go back to root. I can say cd slash I am in root, and now I can go cd and I can just say squiggly like that, and then it takes me directly into my home directory. Now, actually, you got to be a little careful with squiggly, because if you're writing a program, you need to, I think it's better practice to use the full path name. I've run into problems before using the shortcut of squiggly. And so when I program or I do real coding, I tend to use the absolute path going back to root. And so I would say a better way to do it would be cd and say slash home. We saw that. And then slash pjm. And then that brings me back to my home directory. Now, what did I just show you there? I just showed you that you can start stringing these commands together to get where you want all in one step. And so I could say cd, and the slash takes me to the root, and then home takes me to the home directory, and then pjm takes me to the pjm directory, and then I could go into what I know here is downloads. Okay, and boom, there I am there. Well, what if I wanted to go to, let's see, what if I wanted to go, I know that there is that folder music. How could I get to music? Well, I could go back to root slash home slash pjm and then slash music. I could do that. Or I could just say I want a CD, I want to go up one, and then I want to go back down into music, like that. And now LS, I am in music. How would I go back? I could say CD, go up one, and then go down into downloads. All right. Or if I wanted to go back to music, I could do it like this, CD, squiggly, slash music. So that's saying go to the home directory and then drop down into music. And then I could also say, I could go CD, and then I could go all the way back to the top, and I could say go to the root, then go to home, then go to PJM, and then go to downloads. Like that, I could navigate all the way to the top. But what you got to be real careful is that, like, let's say I want to go CD root. Now I'm back in my root directory and I say LS. Well, let's say I wanted to go to PJM and I say CD PJM. Oops, no such file or directory, because it doesn't look down beneath the first level. So what I've got to do is I've got to give the path from where I am to PJM. And so I would do CD, and then I'm already in root. So this time I don't have to put the leading slash because I'm already in root. And so it would see home, okay, and then PJM, and then we were going to downloads, I believe. Okay, so you see, you can't jump into a folder. You've got to give it a roadmap from where you are to where you want to be. You might go up, 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 and then down, down, down. And so let's try that. Let's say I wanted to go to music. Well, I could take a long path. I could say CD and go dot, dot, which would go up. That would put me in PJM. And then I could go dot, dot, and that would put me in home. And then I could go dot, dot, and that would put me in root. And then I could go back to home, and then back to PJM, and then back to music. So you see, this is not a good way to do it, but it's just showing you, you give it a path. And when I am sitting here, let's see, I'm sitting here right now in downloads and I'm trying to go to music. There are many paths for me to get to music. And here is a particularly not smart one, but it brought me to music. So you see how that works. Again, you can use the squiggly as a shortcut, and you squiggly always takes you no matter where you are. And so let's go back and let's say I go CD to root, And if I did CD to PJM, if I do CD to PJM, is that going to work? No, because I didn't give it the complete path. I would have to go /home/PJM to give it the complete path. But squiggly, you can get to from anywhere. So I can always go just with squiggly, and I always end up back reference to home. Okay, so that's kind of the way that works. Okay, so we have looked at the root. We have looked at stringing commands together. We've looked at ls. We've looked at cd. We have looked at quite a bit of different things. Now, there's another useful command. Let's say I'm going to cd into I'm going to look ls, and I'm going to cd into downloads. Okay, and then I'm going to cd into let's see what I've got here. You might not have all this, but I am going to cd into Jetson inference. Okay, and now I've kind of, let's say I've lost track of where I am, and I want to know absolutely from root where I am. I do a print working directory. PWD is for print working directory. And then, do you see what that does? Is that gives me my path all the way from root to where I am now. I am in /home/PJM/downloads/Jetson inference. And that's very useful, because you tend to get the shorthand of this little squiggly. And if you really want to know where you are, like let's say you got on someone's system and you don't know where your home directory really is relative to the overall directory, you can do this print working directory, and it will show you the complete path. Also, this is kind of neat because you can select over it, and then you can right mouse click and you can copy it, and then you might want to paste that somewhere where you absolutely have the right directory without any mistakes. So that's just something that I have found is pretty useful. So now you can see, let me show you something else you can do. Like, let's see, I am in Jetson inference, and let's say that I want to know what is in my documents folder. I don't have to move to it to look at it. I could say ls, and I'm in Jetson inference, so I need to go up, and that would put me in downloads, and then I need to go up again, and that would put me in home, and then I need to go down into documents. All right, so I'm going to look up and down into documents, and then it lists that for me. But look, I just peeked over there. I didn't go over there. I just peeked over there. So you can work, you can be sitting in one directory and you can be working in another directory. And almost all Linux commands allow you to do things in another directory from a different directory. Like, I just looked inside of documents, even though I'm sitting inside of Jetson inference. And so hopefully that makes sense. Let's go back to our home directory. I'm going to do cd/home/PJM. And again, I kind of don't like the squiggly very much. And so to really learn this, maybe it's better to just do the little bit extra and to not use the shortcut. Okay, so I am back into my home directory, which is /home/PJM. What if we want to install software? There are all types of software packages that you might want to install, and you do those with a command called apt-get. So I want to install an old school Linux text editor, which is called Nano. So I am going to do an apt-get, okay, apt-get install, and then I want to install this program called Nano. Nano has nothing to do with Jetson Nano. Nano is a text editor. It has nothing to do with the Jetson Nano. It just happens to be named the same thing. So what if I do apt-get install Nano, and I get a could not lock file. I get an error, permission denied. What does that mean? That means that the Jetson Nano is not going to let me, PJM, because I am just a lowly user, is not going to let me install software or change the system. You need to have administrator privileges, which on the Linux system is called a super user. All right. And how do you operate as a super user? It is called sudo. And most people say sudo. So S-U-D-O. I say sudo just because it's more like how it is spelled, but super user do. So people call it sudo. So I'm going to say sudo. That means execute as the super user. And then I'm going to do the same thing. Apt get install nano. All right, and there it goes. And it's going out and it's finding it. Pro tip, you got to be connected to the internet for this to work. So, I mean, these are things they don't tell you, but I'm doing this, it doesn't work. Oh, I wasn't connected to Wi-Fi. Okay, so that is the thing that you learn is you've got to be connected to the internet if you want these things to work. All right, so let me, where am I, PWD? Oh, I am in my /home/PJM. And so let's see. I think I want to edit a text file, but I don't want to be up here in my main, home directory, my main /home/PJM directory. I want to make a directory to play around in. So how would I do that? Mkdir. You notice that I am in home. So if I just say mkdir, I'm going to call it scratch just to kind of play around in. And now if I do an ls, look, I've got a new, directory called Scratch. All right, I can go down into that, S-C-R-A-T-C-H. I'm now in Scratch, and Scratch is empty because I just made it. Well, I could now write a little text file. So let's see, I think I'm going to say nano, and then I want it in the current directory, and so I'll just give it a file name. If I wanted it in a different directory, I would give the path to where I want it, but I'm just in Scratch, and I'm going to put it in Scratch, so I will say my dogs, and because it's a text file, I'm going to put txt just because that's good practice. There's nothing magic about txt. You could call it .text, you could call it .cat, you could call it whatever you wanted, but the standard is a simple text file. You put the after the dot of .txt. All right, now that opens the program Nano. And so this is an empty text file. So what were my dogs? My first dog was named Spook. My second dog was named Susie. My next dog was Spook number 2. And then I had a dog called Little Sweet. And then I had a dog called Little Elmo. And then I had a dog called Ginger. And now my dog is called Indigo. All right, so those are the dogs of my life. Now, how do I save this record of the dogs of my life? Well, I put Control O, and then you see down here, it knows that you want to leave and save, but it says, what do you want to save it to? Well, I want to save it to what I opened it as, which was mydogs.txt, but you could type something else in here if you wanted to change it under a different name. That would then leave mydogs.txt empty, but I don't want it empty. I want this to be mydogs.txt. So I click enter. And now how do I get out of the program? Control X like that. Let me show you another little trick. Like if you want to go back to your last command on the keyboard, hit the up key. And if you hit the up key, it will take you to your last command. Or in fact, you can keep hitting it and it will take you to lots of last commands. But I want to nano this again. And then let's say that I want to uppercase the S there just so I change something. What if I say Control X without saving? If I say Control X, it says, do you want to save it? Well, yeah, I want to save it. And then I hit enter, and then I can get out just with a Control X. I don't have to do a Control O followed by Control X. So that's just a little bit about how you can do things in Nano. So now I have a file called My Dogs, and it's in Scratch. So let me create another one. I'm going to say, well, let me do this. I'm going to go CD, I'm going to go dot, dot, and then I'm going to go into Music like that. LS, and I'm in Music. Now I want to create my cats file. Okay, so I'm going to do nano, and then my cats, but I want my cats over in my Scratch folder. So where would I go from Music? I would say go up, and then go down into Scratch, S-E-R-A-T-C-H. Okay, I hope that is right, Scratch, yeah. I'm dyslexic, so it's really hard for me to not get things in the wrong order. So dot dot slash scratch, and then I want my cats.txt. Now this is another thing I'll say here. One thing that you never want to do in Linux is you never want to name a file with a space in it. Now, when you're on Windows, you can make your file names a paragraph long, and you can put spaces everywhere, and you can do everything, and it's really sloppy. You can end up getting in trouble if you put spaces in file names and things like that on Linux. And so this is what I like to use. It's called a bumpy font, or some people call it camel font, and that is the new words after the first word is capitalized first letter. So my cats. You see how easy that is to read as opposed to my cats like that. Because if it's just all lowercase, it's not necessarily really easy to see exactly what the words were. But if you do it, like, a good way to do it would be my cats like that. Absolutely don't do my cats like that. You will end up in problems that will make your life miserable. So you could do it that way. Another thing some people do is like that, separate the words with a hyphen, or some people separate them with an underscore. I don't like the underscore very well. I like the hyphen. The thing is, what I would suggest is you figure out the way you like to do it and then always be consistent, because then as you're doing things in programming, you always kind of go back to the way you normally do it and you typically don't get messed up. And so I kind of like the bumpy font or the camel font. So now I'm in music, but I'm creating a file over in Scratch, hopefully. Boom, there I am. Okay, this is my list of cats. I do not like cats. I do not have cats. Cats are evil. Okay, now how do I save this? I do a Control X. Do you want to save it? I will type a Y for yes, enter, and boom, I am out of there. Now let's look over there from here. I'm going to do an LS. Where do I want to look? Let's go all the way up. I'll go slash home, slash PJM, slash scratch, and let's see what's in there. Or wait a minute, we put that. Yeah, we put it in Scratch. And boom, there it is. I have my cats and I have my dogs. That is pretty cool. So we're seeing kind of just with simple examples how to work around. Now, when you see these commands that these guys are using, you're starting to kind of understand they're making you go around in directories and doing things in one directory from another directory or doing things like that. So I'm just kind of getting you comfortable with that file structure. Okay, let's think about doing a little bit of very, very simple programming, just because if we write a few very simple programs, it'll kind of help you see how programs operate and interoperate with Linux. So I think that I am going to, I'm just going to go back over CD into Scratch. I'm going to go dot dot and then into Scratch like that. Now LS, I am in Scratch. All right, let's play around a little bit with Python. And one of the neat things about Python, you guys that are coming from the Arduino world, that's a little bit more like C, to where you write all your code, you compile your code, and then it gives you error messages that you don't understand, and you got to go in and figure out why your program isn't working. And so so like the Arduino, it compiles all your code at once. Python is an interpretive language, which means it sort of reads a line, it compiles that line and runs it, and then reads the next line, and so it interprets each line by line. Well, the kind of neat thing about that is you can sort of write Python programs from the command line. And the way you do that is I can open up the Python shell just by typing Python. Now, your Nano comes with Python 2.7 and 3.6, something like that. If you just type Python, you'll go to 2.7. 2.7 is dead at this point, and so I like hung on to 2.7 like way too long. I'm on 3 now. Don't even think about going to Python 2. Go right to 3. So the way you get to Python 3 is you just type in Python 3 like that and enter. And now you see you don't have a dollar sign. You have those three greater than signs. And now you're at the command line of Python. So you can type Python commands. So I can say x equals 7. Okay, then I can say print x, and it prints 7. I could say y is equal to 3, and I could say z is equal to x plus y, and then I could say print z, and then it says 10. Okay, so you see, I'm writing code one line at a time. I could say print hello AI world. Tip our hat to Dusty there in his most excellent Hello AI World tutorial. I really love that. I'll tell you, Dusty did a great job on that. And I'm trying to get you to the point that you can do the Hello AI World demo. Okay, so this is sort of like the foundation that would allow you to do the Hello AI World and kind of know what you're doing as you're going through it. So I can say print Hello AI World, or I can say MSG is equal to Hello AI World. And then what I can do is I could say print msg like that. Okay, so you see, I am writing Python code one line at a time from the Python shell. Okay, how do you get out of the Python shell? Control D. Now, a lot of times to kill things in the terminal, in the Linux terminal, you kill it with Control C, but the Python shell you kill with Control D. I've been in some programs that you kill with Control X. So usually either Control X, Control C, or Control D will kill whatever you want to kill to just get back to your terminal. Okay, so we can write Python one line at a time, or we could write Python this way. I could say nano, and I could nano a Python program. So I'm going to say nano, and what I am going to do is I think I will nano a hello AI world.py. Now, actually, kind of the py is sort of important. You could call it anything. But when you call it .py, it notifies the editor that it's a Python program, and sometimes the editor will give you some helps and some hints. And so it's kind of good to call a Python program .py. Okay, so now we have our editor open, and so I'm going to say msg message is equal to, in quotes, because it's a string, hello AI world, like that. And then I'm going to say print message like that. Ooh, I better say MSG like that. All right, now what do? I do a Control X, and then I do a, do I want to save it? Yes. And then I do an enter, and boom, here I am. Now what if I said Python 3? I want to run Python 3 program. What do I want to run? Hello AI world.py. What did I do? Hello AI world. Oh, I said hello. Okay. So we will do hello AI world. And it still doesn't like it. The problem of, let's do an ls. Okay, there's hello AI world. I have got a, I'm going to do a Python 3, hello AI world dot, oh, I dyslexic LRD, okay. And it looks so right to me when I look at that, I'll tell you. You guys are learning from someone dyslexic. Boom, hello AI world. So it ran the program, it did what we asked it to, and so we have a program. Okay, let's write another simple little program. Let's say, let's do a nano, and let's just say add.py like that, and then we come up, and then we are going to say x is equal to input. What is your first number? Like that. And then we are going to say y is equal to input. This is how you get user input from the keyboard. And then say what is your second number, like that. And then we are going to say z is equal to x plus y. Now, I'll be honest with you. I don't know in Python if this is going to read it in as a number or a string. So if we get an error, I need to convert those to integers. But we will just try this and see what happens. I don't know if it's going to read it as the string 3 as opposed to the number 3. And then I'm going to print, and I'm going to print x plus y. I print that as a string is equal to that whole thing is a string. And then what I am going to print is z, like that. Okay, so I'm doing a print where I'm stringing several things together. Okay, we're going to get out of this with a control X, yes, enter. And then what we are going to do is Python 3. And then what are we going to do? Add.py, like that. And then what is your first number? I'll say 3. What is your second number? 7. And then 3 plus 7 is 37. Okay. 3 plus 7, home gamers, is not 37. So what happened there? Let's go back in nano add.py. It read the number. It read 3 as a string, and it read 7 as a string, and then it read that plus as concatenation. So it read it as 3 concatenated with 7, which is 3, 7, 3 put beside 7. So how do we do that? Well, we want to convert that input. Input reads as a string, I guess, and so we're going to change it to an integer like that. So it will read as a string, and then right here in that line, it's going to convert it to an integer like that. And I need to make this an integer like such, and then come over here like that. Okay, also, I want to put a space after number so that it doesn't run the number into my sentence. And in fact, I could put like a colon there. Always, you know, do a good job on your formatting. Okay, control X to get out of it. Yes. Okay. Now let's do Python 3 add.py. Okay, what is your first number? 3. What is your second number? 7. 3 plus 7 is 10. Boom. Okay. And I could have said x plus y, and it would have said 3 plus 7 is 10, or I could put the variables in x plus y. Either way, you can kind of do it however you want. But you see, the point of this is to show you that we are running programs from the command line. All right. Now, this is what you have to see. Let's go cd ./music. All right. Now what you have to see is there's nothing in here. Now it always finds Python, because when Python is installed, it puts it in like the master path. So wherever you are, you can always find Python. Okay, but now if I say Python 3, and if I say add.py, it says can't open add.py, no such directory. Well, what does that mean? Or, you know, no such file. I just made that file. Yeah, but now you're in music. So you've got to give it not the path to Python. You've got to give it the path to the Python program that you want to run. So I would say Python 3. And I could do it a lot of different ways, but let's go all the way to root. home.pjm.scratch and then /add.py, like that. Okay. So I'm going to run that program, add.py, but I gave it the whole path. Okay. What's your first number? 3. What's your second number? 2. Boom. 3 plus 2 is 5. Now, you guys don't laugh at me, because really, if you understand this simple stuff, then the complicated stuff gets easier. And what you're learning here is that if you run a Python program, you got to give it, if you're not in the directory that file is in, you got to give it the path to the directory. All right. And one of the things that happens a lot of times when you're trying to follow someone else's code. Let's say that Chris at NVIDIA wrote a program, and he's Chris, and he said, "Well, go to /home/Chris/programs." Well, what you need to see is you're not Chris, and so you very well could do exactly what he wrote, and it might not work, because what you need to do is you need to put your name there. So, you know, if you understand what I'm showing you today, when you go out and learn from other people, you're not just copying exactly what they're doing, you're understanding what it is that they are doing. And so things like what that dot dot means, it means go up one. The slash means go back to root. Okay. The squiggly means you're at home. The dollar means it's ready for a command. The greater, greater, greater means you're inside the Python shell. So you guys are learning some good stuff here today. I love this stuff. I have so much fun with this sort of stuff. Okay, so let's see. We wrote some. We wrote some programs. I need to write one more program. And the reason I'm doing this is we just got to have some files to work with. So I am going to Nano, and from here I am going to go up, and then I'm going to go down into Scratch, and I'm going to go mycats.py, right? We had mycats.txt, mycats.py, and then what I say is msg is equal to, in quotes, because it's a string. I think you can use single or double quotes in Python 3. Okay, so I'm going to say cats are evil. All right. And then print msg like that. And then we'll do a control X. Yes, enter. And then I am going to run it from here. So I'll say Python 3. And this time I'll go all the way from root slash home. And remember, you're not PJM. You put your username there, but I'm PJM. And then I'm in Scratch. Okay, S-C-R-A-T-C-H. And then slash mycats.py. Boom, cats are evil. All right. All right, guys, we are making a lot of progress here. Okay, what if we go back? Let's go down to Scratch. So I'm going to say CD, and I'll go home. I'm trying to do it lots of different ways. I'm going home and then down into Scratch, and I do an LS, and I've got Hello AI World. And let's say that Hello AI World is really too long, and I want to rename that. How do I rename that file? Well, I do a move MV. Okay, I do a move MV. And what do I want to move? I want to move Hello AI World.py, and I want to move it to, we'll just call it AI World.py, right? And then that liked it ls. Look, you see the Hello AI World is gone and the AI World is there. And so move, it's a little counterintuitive, right? It's a little counterintuitive because move is really rename. And so they didn't do like rn for rename, they did mv for move. All right. But I can also move it, like I could move AI World dot pi, which is here, and I could move it to slash home slash pjm slash let's just put it in my main home directory there, slash home slash pjm. Okay, and then let's look ls, and where do I want to look? Up one level, and there is, I hope, AI World. Yeah, that's not a very good place for it, so let's move it back. Move AI World dot pi to Scratch, no leading slash because I'm not going back to root, Scratch excuse me, slash AI World dot pi like that. Ooh, AI, oh, I'm in Scratch already, so I need to go dot dot, that's up, and get AI World, and then put it in my present directory like that. You guys look at that. Make sure you understand this. This is where you get confused. Okay, now let's look ls, and AI World is back where it needs to be. Okay, I can also copy. So I can cp, I can copy AI World.py to Hello AI world.py like that. And right, I'm just working from the directory I'm in to the directory I'm in, so I'm not putting path names. And now if I look at ls, now I have both AI World and I have Hello AI World. Right, I've got AI World and I've got Hello AI World. I should have done a move instead of a copy. How do I get rid of that? I get rid of that with remove rm. And I want to remove AI world.py. Okay. Now, I can also make a directory. So I'm going to mkdir make a directory, go up one, and then create a directory that we are going to call junk. All right. Now, if I do an ls dot dot, that will show me above. And what you can see is I have a junk directory. Now, from where I am, how would I get rid of junk? Well, I would do a rmdir, remove directory, and then go up and then remove junk like that. Okay, it's gone. Bye-bye. I do an ls dot dot, no junk. All right, but let me make junk again. How do I do that? I'd use the up arrow, and I do a make directory up slash junk. Okay, so now the junk should be back there. All right, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to look here and I'm going to copy add.py, and I'm going to copy it to home slash junk. And then let's see, I don't know, I'm going to have to look at this and see if that does it. And then I do, yeah, it does it. So I do an ls and dot dot and then slash junk. And I've got add.py in junk. And then if I look where I am now, because I did a copy, I've got add.py here as well. Does that make sense? I hope it's all right. So you can see that we've got it here and we've got it there. Now I'm going to delete that folder. Okay, so I am going to do a remove directory, and I want to remove up one, and then I want to remove junk. Okay, and it says junk failed to remove because the directory is not empty. Now imagine you had 100 files over there, and what it wants you to do is it wants you to delete the files out of the folder before you can delete the folder. All right, and that is kind of like one of the things when you're very early on in Linux that really goofs you up, that you can't just eliminate the whole directory. You have to get rid of the stuff out of the directory and then remove it, unless you do the command rm, so that's remove, and then recursively, okay, that means over and over, and then what do I want to remove? I want to remove junk, so I go up, because right now I'm in Scratch, I go up to my home directory, and then it can see junk, and then I just do junk. And that's kind of like getting rid of it and the horse it rode in on. Okay, it gets rid of everything. It gets rid of the directory, and it gets rid of the contents. So let's see if that works with one command. And then I will do an ls dot dot, and that junk directory is gone. And everything that was in it. Okay, so I'm still down in Scratch, and I have this, and this is pretty good. So I've done a move, I've done a copy, I've told you the importance of never using a space and a file name in Linux. Okay, and so now let's see, you know, this Scratch, the problem is it's kind of like Scratch. I put everything in Scratch. So I'm gonna make a new directory. I'm gonna say make directory, and that directory is going to go up, and then it's going to be text files like that. Okay, and then I'm going to make a directory, and it is going to be python files like that. Now if I do an ls looking up one level, look at that. I have Python files and I have text files. Now, the problem is this nonsense in Scratch is I've put a bunch of different types of files all in the same folder. Now, what I'd like is I'd like to move my Python files to my Python folders and my text files to my text. How many times have I said folder? I think at least three. Okay. Directories. Okay, you guys really should have put out a dollar jar for me for that. We got to stop thinking about folders and we got to start thinking of directories. Okay, so what you could do is you could imagine doing a copy and then add.py like that, and then move it up and then move it down into Python files. Okay. You could do that, but then, like, what if you had 500 different files? Then you would have to just do it over and over and over and over. And what I want you to see is it's going to kind of get to where you start loving Linux because there's very simple commands that do really, really complicated functions. And so what I could do is, instead of doing that, I could say copy. The wildcard is star. So star matches everything. So this is saying move star dot pi. Okay, move star, copy star dot pi up and then down into Python files dot, no, just Python files. Okay, like that. So copy everything that's a dot pi, star, the wildcard matches everything, dot pi. So anything dot pi is going to be moved. The wildcard is like one of the most powerful things that has ever been developed. Okay. I misspelled Python files. It should have been an uppercase F. Like that. Okay. Now let's LS and let's look up and then down into Python files. Like that. And then there they are. All right, there they are. What if instead of that, what if I had said copy? What if I had said copy and just put star and then into Python files? You guys tell me what that would do. Would it move nothing? Would it move everything? Okay, star matches everything. So now if I do an ls and I do a dot dot slash Python files, oh my goodness, I ended up with everything over there, including my text files. Well, what could I do? Well, I could do an rm, and then I could say minus r to do it recursively. I believe this will work. And then I will go dot dot, and then I will go down into, I will go down into Python files, and then I will do a star. I want to remove star dot txt. I'm not sure if I really need that minus r or not. Let me try it without the minus r, because I think that that star, a wildcard, will kind of be recursive. But let's see. Okay, it liked it. Now let me look over there in it. And that got rid of my text files. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Do you see that wildcard? It's very, very powerful. Very powerful, the wildcard. Okay, so let's see now. I have got, let's go back to Scratch and let's look in it. And so I've got my Python files where I want my Python files. Now I got to move my text files. So I can say I can just do a move instead of a copy. I can do a move and I want to move everything.txt. And where do I want to move it? I want to move it into slash home slash pjm. You put who you are there and then slash my, what did I call that? Text files, I believe. Text files. Okay. So this time I'm going to move. All right. And then what I can do is I can do an ls, and you can see that the text files are missing. And what I want to do now is I want to just see. Okay. So you see that. That in the first time I copied them, the Python files, I copied them, and then these I did indeed move them. So the difference between move and copy. All right, now let's look and say, well, what if I try to remove, and I try to remove Scratch, S-C-R-A-T-C-H. Okay, first problem is it doesn't see Scratch. Why I am in Scratch, and I don't know what I am in. If I am in Scratch, I don't see Scratch. So what could I do? I could say CD, go up, and then look down into Scratch and remove it. Okay, oops, I shouldn't have done CD. I meant remove directory. Okay, and I want to remove directory. I want to go, I should have done remove directory the first time. So I'll say remove directory Scratch. Okay, and it says you can't remove it because it doesn't see it. Doesn't see it because you're in it. So I could say remove directory, and then I could say go up and then look down into Scratch and remove that. Now I've got the problem that it's not empty. So what would I do? RM and then minus R. Notice I'm deleting the folder that I'm deleting the directory that I'm in. Rm minus R, and then what I would do is, that's recursively, and then I want to remove, go up, and then remove scratch. All right, and then it does it. It looks like it does it. Okay, how am I still in Scratch? That's kind of crazy. I wasn't expecting that. Okay, Scratch is gone, but it let me still be in it. So it deleted it, but it didn't take me out of it. So that was kind of unusual. I wasn't expecting that. I was expecting it to pop me up into the next one above it. So let's look now, and like if we try to go back to Scratch, it should be gone now. Okay, yeah, so Scratch is gone now. Okay, guys, this has been a fun lesson. Hopefully this gives you enough that when you start installing libraries and you start doing things, you'll know a little bit more about how... Little hay fever is all, nothing to be concerned about. Okay, so let's do one more thing. Remember how I did the sudo apt get install nano to put a program in? What if you want to get rid of a program? Well, we could do a sudo apt get remove nano like that. And then it's going to come in and say, do you really want to kill nano? Yeah, so this is how to delete a program. You don't go in and delete files. You do an uninstall. So apt get remove to get rid of something. Okay, now let's look and see where we are. Let's change directory into text files. And then if I try to do a nano, or let me do an ls, and now if I try to do a nano of my dogs.txt, doesn't know what nano is because nano was removed. I'll show you one other thing. Let me do a sudo apt get install nano. Let me bring it back. And this is just a little thing that I do that I have found helpful. It'll take just a second. Okay, it should now. Let's see if we come back and say nano mydogs.txt. All right, so now we can nano again because we reinstalled it. When I remove something, the darn thing... the darn thing when you do an apt get remove, it seems to me like sometimes it like deactivates the program, but it doesn't really get rid of it. And so I like to kind of do like an apt get purge, and it seems like purge really, really seriously gets rid of everything. So apt get purge nano, okay, I did a sudo, yeah. All right, so this really kind of does a more thorough job of getting rid of old programs, because sometimes if you're not careful, your Linux system gets a little kind of like a bunch of old worn out stuff that you're not using anymore in it. So I found just personally sometimes I have more luck using apt get purge than apt get remove. But we can install with apt get install. Sometimes you need to use sudo apt get install, sudo apt get remove. If you're installing Python libraries, you a lot of times will install them with pip, and we'll talk about pip probably next week in the lesson. We will do that. But we have learned ls shows you what's in your current directory, dot dot takes you up, squiggly takes you home, cd is for change directory. We can always find out where we are with print working directory, and that will show us the path of precisely where we are all the way back from root. We learned to use nano to edit a text file. We learned how to run a Python program from the command terminal. We learned how to move things with MV. We learned how to remove things with RM. We learned to make directory MKDIR. We learned to remove directory with RMDIR. We learned how to remove recursively to get rid of the directory and the contents. And so I think we've learned a lot today. And even though for a lot of guys, this is going to be very basic stuff, for a guy coming from Arduino, this is the stuff that you don't know that makes it where you never get beyond just running someone else's demo or just copying and pasting their commands. Hopefully, this will sort of allow you to see what all that stuff means that you're doing, and if you can understand, and then you will be able to do it on your own. Hey guys, I had a lot of fun today. If you like this video, give us a thumbs up. If you have any questions, leave comments down below. I would be happy to try to answer your comments. And I hope you will tune in to the next lesson, which will be the NVIDIA Explore AI at Home Python edition, because I think that is the other foundation that you need to get. Okay, guys, Paul McWhorter from toptechboy.com. I will talk to you guys later.